boys and girls. This month we're filming at the Evansville Wartime Museum in Evansville, Indiana. This museum is a memorial to an important part of our history, and our true story today also happened during World War II. You know by now that each month this year we have featured real characters, heroes in the Bible. But maybe they seem to you like their life was too different from yours, their clothes too weird. What do those people have to do with your life? Well, that's exactly what Jake Deshazer thought when he sat in Sunday school as a boy. Everybody likes a good story, and Jake's life is a remarkable true story of courage, survival, and eventually love. Jake was born in Salem, Oregon. He must have heard the good news about Jesus dying on a cross 1,000 times, but he wasn't interested in listening. Every morning, Jake's stepfather would read an entire chapter out of the Bible. But 9-year-old Jake would be distracted thinking about all the work he and his brother Glenn needed to get done. When Jake graduated high school in 1931, the Great Depression was in progress. That meant money and jobs were scarce and he couldn't go to college. Sadly, he also stopped attending church. Jake's sister Helen would try to talk to him about Jesus, but he could not accept that Jesus was more than an average guy. Jake decided to join the Army. He wanted to be a pilot in the Army Air Corps program. If there was going to be any action, he wanted in, but he was told he was too old to be a pilot, and he was sent to train as an aircraft mechanic and bombardier. One day, Jake was peeling potatoes at the March Field base outside of Los Angeles when there was an announcement on the loudspeaker. Attention! We have just received word that the United States fleet stationed at Pearl Harbor has been attacked by the Japanese. Significant damage and loss of life has been reported.
December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy.
The United States declared war on Japan. Each time Jake heard of an attack, he grew angrier. He wanted to make his mark against the enemy. And one day his captain said, "We need volunteers for a dangerous mission." Jake raised his hand. After training, Jake and the other 24 crews were called to a briefing room. He met famous Lieutenant Colonel Jimmy Doolittle. About all they were told is that they would be flying a Mitchell B-25 bomber. It was not until all the planes had flown out of San Francisco and they were 10 miles out to sea that the soldiers received briefing. "This ship is bound for Tokyo." Their planes would take off the deck of the USS Hornet, fly over Japan, and bomb targets. "Some of you will come back as heroes, some as angels," Doolittle said. Jake felt scared. "Army pilots, man your planes!" The Japanese had spotted their presence and warned Tokyo. Jake's plane, the Bat, was the last plane in line on the deck of the ship. "Get ready to drop bombs at 500 feet. I see target." Jake looked out of the front of the nose, and there was their first target, a group of oil storage tanks. Jake pulled the release and dropped 2 of the 500-pound bombs. The next target was an aircraft factory. Jake could smell the smoke from shots being fired at them from the ground. Jake released the last of the bombs, which crashed through the roof of the building and exploded in flame. Mission accomplished. The pilot banked away, turned south, and they went from Japan out over the ocean. But it wasn't long until they ran out of fuel. They had no place to land, which left them with one choice. "Get ready to jump!" They had heard the Japanese most likely controlled the area below. With no fuel left, they had no choice but to leave the plane behind. Jake had never jumped out of a plane before, but he made sure the handle of the ripcord was free, and he began falling into the darkness. The next morning, Jake was reunited with his entire crew, but not in a good way. They had all been captured. Handcuffed and blindfolded, they were taken away to prison. That night, sitting in his cell with lice crawling all over him, he thought back to his childhood religion. His family had always prayed and talked about spending eternity with Jesus. It had been a long time since Jake had thought about those things. He knew if his mother was there, she would tell him to repent of his sins. 1 John 1:9 in the Bible reads, "If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness." But Jake's heart was still closed. He was not going to pretend to believe in God. when he didn't. During the next 3 years, all the Doolittle Raiders would endure almost unspeakable hardships as they were regularly beaten and left bloody and bruised. Jake tried not to pay attention to the rats and lice that crawled all over everything. He was alone, caged, and nearly starved. Food was a scoop of rice with some gray liquid with fatty blobs floating on the top. And inside the bowl, there was maggots and worms. Everyone was suffering, but Jake especially worried about Bob Metter. It was obvious he was getting weaker and weaker. One day Bob had said to Jake, "Jake, I do believe that Jesus Christ is Lord and coming King, and he is God's son." And as they continued to weed, Bob told Jake he believed God had everything under control. He wished he could believe those words, but he felt even more hatred for the Japanese and the guards. Soon Bob died, but after his death, conditions at the prisons changed. The prisoners were allowed to read books, and one of them was the Bible. Each man could have the Bible for 3 weeks before he had to pass it on to the next man. Jake waited 9 weeks before it was his turn to read the Bible. Jake started reading the Old Testament, reading it straight through, and then he read the New Testament. Then he reread it. This book that he had not cared about when he was a boy, now he could not put down. What amazed Jake as he read was how the Old Testament and the New Testament meshed together to tell the story of Jesus. Jake was deeply touched by the accounts of Christ's suffering at the hands of the Jews and the Romans. And as he spent time reading and rereading the Bible, Jake became aware of a presence in the cell with him. The presence, he concluded, was God right there beside him. The feeling overwhelmed Jake. Someone really cared about him. On June 8, 1944, as Jake continued hungrily reading the Bible, he read Romans 10:9. "If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved." Right there in his cell on the other side of the world, Jake bowed his head and prayed, "Lord, though I am far from home and though I am in prison, I ask your forgiveness." Despite the fact that he was a prisoner of war in solitary confinement in a brutal Japanese prison, his heart was filled with joy. Joy like he'd never felt before in his life. And at that moment, he would not have traded places with anyone. On the outside, everything was wasting away. But on the inside, everything had changed. One particular guard was especially brutal to Jake. At first, Jake's anger toward the guard remained the same. He felt resentment and a desire to get revenge. But as he sat through the night and day reciting Bible verses aloud to himself, and he memorized and pondered Jesus' admonition for Christians to love and forgive their enemies, Jake knew that was what he had to do. One morning when that guard came on duty, Jake said, "Good morning." The guard looked at Jake. Jake asked about his family, his life. Jake and the guard started to have a connection. And days later, the guard slipped a cooked sweet potato through the slot in the cell door. Jake could not believe it. By doing what the Bible said and loving and forgiving his enemies, the situation had changed for the better between him and the guard. But Jake and his fellow prisoners were moved one last time, and it was the worst prison of all. And after a month of that agony, Jake thought, "I can't do this anymore." And he began to pray, and as he prayed, he thought of Daniel, and he remembered how God had shut the mouths of the lions so they did not attack Daniel. And Jake just slipped off his stool right there in the prison cell, and he just got on his knees, and he knelt. A guard came by and peered into the cell, and when he saw what Jake was doing, he beat on the door. Jake heard the guard walk away and returned with several other guards, and the cell door swung open, and Jake braced himself for a beating. But there was no beating. Instead, the guards just walked around Jake without saying a word. Jake felt more confident every day that he would be released. Jake promised God that he would thank his mother and stepfather for his godly upbringing. One night he heard a voice speak to him. "Jake, you're called to go and teach the Japanese people and go wherever I send you." As the war came to an end, Jake went back to America. The first thing Jake did when he got home was to call his parents, and he was relieved that they were both still living. Jake told people everywhere he went about his experience as a prisoner of war and how that in the midst of that he had responded to the good news of Jesus. He went on to share that in an instant his life was changed. As you watch this video, are you like Jake? Are you tired of feeling angry, depressed, despondent, and hopeless? You might be in a prison of your own making, or maybe you're in a prison due to the actions of someone else. Either way, Jesus is able to set you free in an instant. All that is necessary is to do as Jake did. Look to Jesus, confess with your mouth, make him Lord of your life. Believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead. Let the love of Jesus control your life. Jake's story doesn't end here. After the war, Jake decided to be a missionary to Japan. It was about this time that he met Florence Matheny. She was also training to become a missionary. And after spending much time together, they were married in a church and prepared to go to Japan. During this time, Jake wrote down his experiences and a tract was published titled, I Was a Prisoner of Japan. God would later use that tract to bring healing to many people in Japan. And he would stay in Japan for almost 30 years. And Jake would meet and forgive his former prison guards. He would meet the brother of the emperor. He told the prince what it meant to be a follower of Jesus. Jake would speak to thousands of people, telling them how God had changed his heart from hate and anger to love and peace. In fact, Captain Fuchida, who had led the attack on Pearl Harbor, received a copy of Jake's tract. It did not make sense to him that God could turn hatred into love. He brought a Bible and began to read it, and he later turned his life over to Christ. Fuchida eventually came to see Jake Deshazer. The two men who had once been enemies knelt down in prayer together as brothers. They decided to go on tour together in Japan. They knew the Japanese people were hurting and searching, and they knew real peace only comes through Jesus Christ. There is no limit to what God can do when you surrender your life to Him. God can use your life to do heroic things.
I'm not a warrior. I'm too afraid to lose. I feel unqualified for what you're calling me to. Lord, with your strength, I got no excuse. 'Cause broken people are exactly who you use. So give me faith like Daniel in the lion's den. Give me hope like Moses in the wilderness. Give me a heart like David, Lord, be my defense. So I can face my giants with confidence. I'm gonna sing and shout and shake the wall. Stop until I see them fall. I'm gonna stand up, step out when you call. Jesus, Jesus. I'm gonna sing and shout and shake the walls. Won't stop until I see them fall. I'm gonna stand up, step out when you call. Jesus. Give me faith like Daniel in the lion's den. Give me hope like Moses in the wilderness. Give me a heart like David, Lord, be my defense. So I can face my giants with confidence. Yeah! Give me faith like Daniel in the lion's den. Give me hope like Moses in the wilderness. Give me a heart. My giants with confidence.